Executive Vice President, 1199 SEIU, Homegrown Workers Union of New York City.
And on behalf of the Minnesota Cuba Committee, my name is Artis Stimson. I will have the honor to be co-chairing the event tonight.
And first and foremost, we want to thank the sisters and brothers from Cuba for their exquisite performance with the drums. Thank you for bringing that spirit to the event. Thank you for bringing modern Africa to this room. Our first speaker, before we begin the actual program, Brother August has a few words to say about the significance and the symbolism of the room where we're standing. Please take your seat, stop talking to the person next to you, and listen carefully.
Thanks, Estella. We are able to be in this space tonight because there was a struggle. There was a fight to be in this space. There were attempts to tear down this place. And because there was a struggle, this is why we're able to be here. In other words, very much in the tradition of Malcolm X. In the tradition of Malcolm X, the fight that took place. Yes, this is a sacred space. This is a sacred space, and those of us who were living in that particular moment, we didn't know the details. And it slowly began to unfold, but we know we had a major loss. And we've never, in my opinion, really recovered from that loss. So it's why it's so important to know the actual, what Malcolm actually had to say, what he actually thought about, rather than what people are always interpreting Malcolm's ideas. So this is the point that we're here, and I have no doubt Malcolm is here in spirit. In his final years, the Cuban Revolution became even more important for Malcolm X. He had always embraced it. But he realized, especially his own thinking, his own evolution and thinking in the last 11 months of his life, the Cuban Revolution became even more important. So I just wanted to acknowledge that. The fact that we're in this space and so on is very much in the tradition of Malcolm X. And we've got fighters here tonight who understand that very much. Thank you.
To recognize some very special guests that we have with us tonight. Please join us in welcoming Sister Ana Yancy Rodriguez, Ambassador of Cuba to the United Nations.
Bienvenidas, welcome.
that and has been working on this side of the room is my brother Victor Ramos, but better known as Sloan, and you will have a chance to see his work at the end of the evening. You will see him working throughout the evening. Sloan, bienvenido.
Many people in this room know that one of the foremost fighters on behalf of solidarity with the Cuban Revolution has been Pastor Peace and Gifko. And we're very, very, very honored to have here tonight Gail, who has played an important role in filling in on a leadership role in helping to organize this conference. And Gail, without further ado, please.
Good evening. Did y'all have a great time this afternoon? Experience today down at Fordham University. And of course, we want to make sure that you return tomorrow for the closing plenary. It is my profound honor to come tonight to introduce our sister Sandra Ramirez. Sandra, as many of you know, is one of the stalwarts in Cuba that many of us have had the opportunity to work with. Sandra, besides serving for years in the, as a youth leader in Cuba, 16 years with the Union of Young Communists, she's been an instrumental figure at ECAP, the Cuban Institute for Friendship with the Peoples. Right, previously working with our Cuba Solidarity community in Canada, and more recently as director of the North American Division. And I know I speak for all of us, certainly those of us connected to IFCO Pastors for Peace, but I know all of us who've had an opportunity to work with Sandra that we're overjoyed that she's here with us tonight. She gave us a really inspiring introduction earlier today, and I want to ask my dear sister Sandra to come forward. Please join me in welcoming Sandra Ramirez. Woo!
This room is very crowded, so sorry if I made a mistake. Probably I can get a little nervous. But before I begin, I will also want to acknowledge the president, and I think it's a responsibility and a duty of a Cuban to mention that we have here Rafael Cancel Miranda. Its best friends. And I think it's also a commitment to a Cuban young woman like me, and it's also very inspiring to be here, as August Lynn mentioned, at this sacred place where Malcolm X was so understanding. And you know that he lost his life, but he's still continuing with us in his spirit. So, I mentioned some of the things that I would today at the opening session. I think it's so important, the solidarity with Cuba at this moment. You know, we have restored the diplomatic relation between our both countries, and I think it's a show how we can work together on equal basis without imposing any conditions to the Cuban people. But the blockade is still in place. The Guantanamo base is still there against the will of the Cuban people. And programs of subversive actions are part of the regime change program to undermine the Cuban revolution. That's the reason it's so important your solidarity. People might think that everything has been solved, but you know it's not true. So we have to continue counting on your support, on your solidarity, on the will to continue explaining all the difficulties and all the situation we are still facing in Cuba. So this national conference is extremely important. As Aguina had mentioned, it's the first time you organize a conference like this one since 1979. So now we have more than 200 delegates that attended this meeting from 17 states of the United States and 4 provinces of Canada. And we also have one representative of Great Britain that she had traveled. She crossed the Atlantic Ocean to participate here with us at this event. I don't want to talk so much because I did it in the opening session. We know we are going to have excellent speakers later on, but I think we have to work together because there are still many challenges to face. We hope we can continue counting on friends so valuable like you. This activity is for us also an opportunity to express our solidarity to the Nobel causes and to the fights of the different movements here in the United States, like Black Lives Matter, that movement that demands the recognitions of the rights of the immigrants and the Latin people. And I think we also have to express all our solidarity with the Venezuelan people, and the people of Venezuela, and the Venezuelan revolution, governments in Latin America that we are just working to be integrated in one Latin America. So, we think we need to continue working with those ones that demand the respect of the Cuban people and our sovereignty. We will also to continue defending a free and independent Puerto Rican country. And I think this is also a moment, having so many friends like you here, to reiterate that we will never renounce to our principle and to the construction of a socialist country in Cuba. We encourage you to continue the struggle all together, because the victory belongs to us. So, let's down the blockade against Cuba. Let's continue working together. Long live to the Cuban Revolution.
And we want to make sure that our voices are heard this evening. Cuba, sí. Cuba the same way we freed the five prisoners in the same way that we struggle and we won the freedom of Oscar Lopez Rivera. A hero of the Puerto Rican independence movement, please join with your hands together and welcome Don Rafael Cancel Miranda.
It helped us make us feel good. I feel good when I fight back. Those who try to enslave my people. We live in a colonial slavery in Puerto Rico. And we're gonna fight back until we die. Otherwise we don't deserve to be. I don't see well, but I see with you with the heart. Sometimes we speak for life, but I see you with heart. Every embrace I get from you, it makes me feel good. And I thank every embrace, every time you want to take a picture with me, the honor is for me, you know? But I got a point. I spend enough. 28 years in prison. The judge joined in prison. Oh, I was going to start this one way and I forget it. Yo iba a empezar de una manera y me olvidé. Me introduzco. You know, you're supposed to introduce yourself. In Puerto Rico, for the police, I'm a dangerous nationalist. In the police record. But recently, you know how called me the FBI? They warned me. They said, and I got it. In England, they say, I am a non-repentant terrorist. They don't know how much they honor me. They don't know how much they honor me. It's to fight for my people. And when I say my people, I mean starting by the Puerto Rican. I'm Cuban. I'm Venezuela. I'm Peruvian. I'm from Bolivia. I'm a Latin from the Caribbean. I'm Puerto Rican. Puerto Rican from top to bottom. There is nothing in me that is not Puerto Rican. You know? I spent 6 beautiful years in Alcatraz. You know? That's supposed to be so dangerous. That's good. The more dangerous they think I am, the more the better I feel. That means I'm fighting good. Otherwise, they fight me. Good boy. I like you, baby. You know what I mean? And things like that. See? Then, I spent 10 years, 11 months. The last 5 months, 11 months, I was in solitary confinement. There was a strike. There was a strike, and they said I was the one who organized the strike. They abused some prisoners. And they put me 5 months, and they sent me to Marion. In Marion, I met some brother, and I bowed my head to those brothers, to Herman Bell from the Black Panther. He was with me in Marion, Illinois. He's still in prison. 40 years for fighting for his people, Herman Bell, Leonard Bachir, we spent time together, and Mario, he's there in prison because he's fighting his people. I'm still proud of that brother, and we should fight for that brother because they are fighting for us. They fighting for us because they love. Si me preguntas, ¿cuál es la fuerza que me guía?
If you ask me, what is the force that guides me?
It's my love for my people. My love for my people. And my self-respect. I respect myself. If I can look inside of me, and I think I'm straight, I feel good. I feel good. See? So I'm fighting for love and for self-respect. And everyone of you here, you are here because you respect yourself. Otherwise, you've just been fooling around. I was almost say prison, good chilling around, but I won't say that. That's the way we talk. But what I want to say is, I spent all those years in prison, but always as a free man. And they got me many times locked up and solitary confinement. They even here in the Bronx jail, they think hell I'll make it, my feet out there, but that's one thing. You know? But I was always a free man. Could you answer to yourself, I'm a free man? Only those who are free is those who dare to fight back for the justice, like Che Guevara said, for justice. So before I leave, no, let me say in Spanish, I don't get my stuff. I saw it for there in England, I don't know if I saw it, I remember. Because you talk Chinese and you're good people, I try to learn Chinese. If you speak Japanese, German, you're good people. people, I try to talk your language that you, but first of all, my Spanish is you, it's me, right? And every Puerto Rican who lives in the United States, in any place, remember you got a homeland, and it's Puerto Rico. Don't let them steal your land. Don't let them eat your land. In 1898, July 25th, 1898. Before that, May 12, 1898, they bombed San Juan, Puerto Rico, killing off like World War II. Now I remember something Fidel said. Don't forget what they had done to us. Don't forget what they had done to us. And they're still doing. You see what they're doing to Venezuela. They want to kill those people, oppress those people. You know, just like they did to Chile with Pinochet. They did to Cuba with Batista. They did to Nicaragua with Somoza. And they still try to oppress our people. They still try to do it. Fighting for the Cuban Revolution. You're fighting for the freedom of all of us. Fighting for Puerto Rico. I've been in this struggle sign before I got here. But this Puerto Rican, you will see here, there is no power on earth that will make me bow to them and become a slave in my mind. There is no power. Don't let nothing enslave your mind, Puerto Rican brother, while you are giving Puerto Rico libre. Each one of you. Anyone who cares for one another is my brother. Don't matter if he's from the United States, like the brother who is organized here, I'm breaking because one thing, the human being, and if he cares, he's my brother. All you care, I send you an embrace from here, let him be un abrazo, bien grande. And let him translate something from me, whatever. Me voy mañana para Puerto Rico.
I'm going back to Puerto Rico tomorrow.
Of course, I got Puerto Rico again. But I go back tomorrow to Puerto Rico. But I'm going to tell you something. At least a piece of my heart will stay here with each one of you. Remember one thing. No one had the right to enslave you or to oppress you. No one had the right. And my last word at this moment went to be to Malcolm X. Why he was in prison? While Malcolm X was fighting back. And they killed him because he was a proud black man to fight directly.
Thank you.
acknowledge and ask any member of the Venceremos Brigade that is in the room to please stand up. Members of the Venceremos Brigade, anybody in the room? De la Brigada Venceremos. I see a comrade in the back. And I see three comrades in the back, please. And I would like to call especially two women. This is Women's History Month. Sister Rosemary Billy and Lourdes Garcia, that were in the past here in New York City, organizers of the brigade, and they have a small gift that they would like to present to our sister, Ana Yancy, from the Cuban mission.
We have just been dealing with during the whole journey today. We have talking about the beauty of life, because we have been talking about peace, we have been talking about solidarity, we have been talking about friendship, and the only thing that I can say in this very touching moment that I didn't expect it is that we really thank all of you for that selfless solidarity, sincere friendship that you have given to us all of these years. And we need you, just to reaffirm, to reiterate that we need you. We cannot be here without you. The things that the revolution has done, it has done it by itself, of course, because of the Cuban people is a heroic people, are resilient people that can't resist even in the most difficult circumstances. But we cannot have done so without the help, without the support, without the love, without the friendship of all of you, particularly here in the United States, which is the country that has had the hostile policy, that has imposed a very unjust and illegal and unfair blockade against us, which is still there although we have established a relationship between governments. But the blockade is there, and we need that. And even after the lifting of the blockade, we will continue working together, and we will continue needing you, because as Rafael said, there are a lot of noble causes in the world, in the United States, in Cuba, that you have to fight for together. Thank you very much for that beautiful present that is really for the Cuban people, and is also a great example of the friendship and solidarity between American people and Cuban people. Thank you very much.
When some of us began doing Cuban solidarity work, we needed facts, we needed information, and some of us discovered a great periodical coming out of Miami, Areito. And this was an important source of information for us to build upon, to use the facts in order to be able to mount the kind of campaign in solidarity with the Cuban Revolution. And some of us were curious who was the publisher of Areito. And we began to hear rumors that there was somebody actually in Miami who was on the barricades on a day-to-day basis, facing all kinds of death threats in order to be able to defend the Cuban Revolution. Andres Gomez, for many of us, is a hero, exactly because he's been on the barricades in Miami. And we invited him to Minnesota. I don't know if he remembers. I don't know how cold it was. We brought you to Minnesota to speak and so on. And we were very impressed with the brother. We don't know. We never asked him. But rumor had it he was exercising his Second Amendment rights when he came to Minnesota. And we understood why he had to do that. It's exactly because he had been in Miami on the barricades. Without further ado, it's a real honor and a privilege to be able to introduce Andres Gomez.
¡Viva Cuba y viva Puerto Rico libre! I think that all of us realize the privilege that we are experiencing today and tonight of being able to share this night with the living legend of patriotism, of selflessness, of dedicating his life to the well-being and the fulfillment of his people's most fundamental rights, a most tremendous hero of Latin America and Puerto Rico, Don Rafael Cancel Miranda. Governments realize that their policy of permanent aggression against the Cuban people had failed. And why has it failed? Because the decision of the Cuban people to continue this struggle in the construction of their independence, in the construction of their socialism, the construction of their fundamental freedoms, the construction of socialism, which is the construction of a just and more just society. That's why it failed. That is the reason why they had to change policies. Nothing else but the decision of the Cuban people to be free and independent, and build a more just society for themselves and for their future. Now, they're building a more modern socialism, a socialism which is more efficient, a socialism which is more sustainable in today's world. In order to help them build that society with less hardship, we ourselves must struggle in order to help destroy the rest of the policy of aggression against the Cuban people. And the main policy of aggression against the Cuban people is the blockade. Oh, there's no doubt in my mind that the Cuban people, today's population, and the future population of Cuba will be able to build their socialism, maintain their independence and their freedoms. But it will be extremely hard. Extremely hard. And that's why not only us in the United States, but all over the world, we must help defeat the policy of economic aggression against Cuba. And that is our responsibility. In the way we help the Cuban people, or any other people, achieve or maintain their fundamental freedoms, the same thing that Don Rafael was saying, we become more free. We become a more just people, a more decent human being. Because that is what solidarity really means and what it really does to each one of us when we practice it selfishly. By helping the human being, in this case, maintain their freedom and being able to sustain their development with less hardship, we become freer ourselves. We can contribute better to make this society a better society, a more just society. That's what I have learned throughout all these years. That is what my people have taught me. In Miami, I came to Miami when I was 13 years old, and right now I'm 180. I'm older than Rafael. It seems that way. Not that I'm older than Rafael, and that's why I'm a countryman. I have not worked alone by any means all these years. I have always had the support and the work of the members of the Antonio Maceo Brigade, which I head, which this year marks its 40th anniversary.
Have to do and the way we do it.
like Rafael, I started backwards today. I must recognize the honor it is to have been invited to this conference by the organizers of this important effort in the struggle against the policy of permanent aggression against Cuba. The honor it is to be speaking in this hall in tribute to this incredible man that Malcolm X was. What an honor it is to be here with the delegation from that incredible island that is here with us tonight. And I will join, I will ask you, this morning I said, let's keep a moment of silence in tribute to Fidel. Well, today, tonight, I ask you, let's rise up and applaud, an hour of applause to the life of Fidel.
Of different
challenges in you, in different challenges in the building of a selfless socialist society. Temptations are many. Temptations are constant, and they will be more so in this new period. But the Cubans have gone through so much. His leadership, their leadership, has taught us how to be, not only in the present, but in the future. And we have learned, and will be faithful to that learning throughout all these hundreds of years of struggle. It's more than 150 years of struggle. So, thank you so very much. I recognize in you the will to prevail against an evil policy, against Cuba. ¡Viva la Revolución Cubana!
¡Viva!
¡Viva Fidel!
¡Viva!
¡Viva Raúl!
¡Viva!
¡Viva Puerto Rico Libre!
¡Viva!
Brutal police shooting several years earlier of Amadou Diallo. A
authorities refused to bring criminal charges against the police, Luis Rivera, but in 2007, a jury upheld Young's wrongful death lawsuit against the city, finding Rivera 100% responsible for the fatal shooting. Juanita Young has continued to be a fighter. And as a part of that, she visited Cuba a year ago. And so what we'd like to do is to invite Juanita to come forward, say a few words to us before we end tonight. And Juanita, thank you. Welcome.
The New York Police Department changed my life for the worse. I had to get out here and clear my son Malcolm's name for the murder that they have put in my family's face. The system, all they know how to do is shoot us, abuse us, and then put us in jail. I said, well, as a mother, I had to defend my son. They said, he has no rights, your son is dead. I said, yes, he does, I'm his mother, I'm still here. I stood for 7 years trying to clear Malcolm's name. Because according to the DA, Malcolm shouldn't have went for the cop's gun. I said, show me fingerprints on the gun. They had to take it out. Once I got that cleared out, the rest was not a problem. So then I just had to tell my lawyer, I don't care what you do now. Clear my son's name. I don't care about your money. I need my son's name cleared. We went to civil court and we went to trial and he cleared my son's name. During that 7 years of getting out here, I met so many mothers. I was telling Sean today, I said, you know what? I asked you to go first today for a reason. Even though they didn't murder her son, they stole 13 years of his life. So that's got to be hard, not to be able to touch him, see him. I mean, come on. We don't see our sons because they murdered him. But the fact that here this mother gave birth to this young man, who gave them the right for some racist cop system to say he did it? Y'all took 5 kids' lives and said, you guilty. The same man that would have went on his deathbed and committed to saying those 5 young men were guilty, we now have to tolerate as our president. What are we going to do? What are we going to do? You see what he did with them 5 young men. We now have to deal with him for 4 years. When I was here 1 year, and it was another conference they were having in Cuba, and I remember hearing about the Cuban 5, and I'm listening to everybody talk about the Cuban 5. I said, you know, as a mother, I look too many dope mothers. Somebody said to me, Juanita, you serious? I said, I'm serious. How? I don't care what age they are. They steal that mother's child. And you go away in Cuba and your sons are over here. The next thing we know, we're trying to get us to Cuba. Then what happens? Obama lets them go. The Cuban 5 was set free. That wasn't enough. They still said, you want to go to Cuba. I said, I still want to meet the Cuban 5 mothers. They said, okay. I'm thinking I'm going to meet these Cuban 5 mothers. I get to Cuba. I meet Fernanda, one of the Cuban 5. I said, wait a minute, this. The schedules were, I'm like, okay. But at least I got to meet the Cuban Five. But going to Cuba, being in the Federation of Cuban Women's Mansion, how many of us would ever get an experience of sleeping, much walking into a mansion? We lived in that mansion for a week. They cooked for us. They treated us like they knew us. We went around Cuba like, no problem. One day, one of the people who were with us was walking. Somebody said to them, you're not from here. He said, how you know? He said, because I've been watching you, look behind you, look to the side of you, look around you. He said, in Cuba, that does not happen. You don't have to worry about being mugged like that. We were like, whoa. Then here comes the Mayday. Now, you know, we get up at, like I said, I don't know what time of morning, to go to March and Mayday. We had our mother's cry for Justice Banner. And the four of us mothers, no, two of us, because two didn't walk, two of us did walk. And we were waiting, and the data attracted a lot of people that came from all over the country to this May Day, to May 1st. And we were walking, I'm waiting, I'm like, hold up. I don't see no barricades. I don't see no line of police. I'm like, I'm still waiting now. Then I see somebody with a bottle drinking their liquor. I'm like, now I know something's right. Then they tell me, Juanita, Cuba don't live like that. I'm like, what? The police, if they shoot you, they go to jail. We didn't even see a police officer. They might have been there. They must have been in plain clothes. Not nobody came and bothered that rally, that march. And I'm like, okay, I don't want to know. The guy says to me, oh, so you're a couple more blocks. Okay, walk a couple more blocks. Oh, I mean a couple more blocks. No problem. I'm gonna tell you, we go and get a taxi. Will we value our stuff here? I see these people with these cars. We got in the car, I'm like, are you sure it's gonna make it? He says, oh, don't worry about it. I'm like, I tell you, with all honesty, if I could have been living in Cuba, I wouldn't have to stand here and talk about the death of my son. The way people live in Cuba. They tell me, one of the Federation from Cuba women, she's gonna get mad because I don't remember name. I'm legally blind, so I need an eye operation. She said to me today, Juanita, what's going on with your eye? I'm like, I'm still gonna do it. She said, we still got it. I'm like, I know. But you see what happened, me being hard-headed, they tell me don't drink, tell us don't drink the water. I ended up drinking not even a half a glass of water. I ended up getting sick in Cuba. Didn't let it just turn me away, because it could have been, hey, I still stay there. The doctors tried to convince me to stay in Cuba so that they could treat me. But in order for that to happen, I would have to inconvene someone, because the people in Cuba barely speak English. So we need an English and a Spanish speaking person. Our plane left the next day. I told the doctor, I said, just give me the pain medicine, I'll go back and deal with the situation when I go back. Let me tell you, I'm still dealing with that situation. Because that's neither here nor there. Cuba, I take you anytime. I had an excellent time. Y'all need to visit Cuba. I'm telling you. Thank you.
Thank you, Juanita, for sharing your experience in Cuba. I was very shocked, just like you, when they told me I had to be up at 4 o'clock in the morning to be at 5 o'clock meeting people to go to the parade, but it was an experience.
Yeah.
I just have a series of announcements to make before I call the next person. Sisters and brothers from Canada have the 7th International Che Guevara Conference, October 27th to the 29th, 2017. And it's 100 years since the Russian Revolution and 50 years of the Cuban Revolution. And the title of the conference is From the Russian Revolution to the Cuban Revolution. Please pick up the flyers in the back. They will be very pleased to give you more information about it. Also, the Cuban caravan is coming to town Saturday, April 15th at 7 p.m. Hollywood, I need new glasses. Oh, Hollywood Church, I say Hollywood. Hollywood Church, Iglesia Santa Cruz, 715 West 179th Street. Please take the flyers. Let's go and show our solidarity, our support to the Cuban caravan. And last but not least, this program is being live streamed by Facebook.com, picturethestruggle.org. I hope you have the better side of me in this live stream, and the skinny side too. And now it gives me, just one very brief announcement. Because I come from a healthcare workers union, for the members of 1199, our solidarity with the Cuban Revolution is special. A number of our members, including the president of our union, and our former president of 1199, Dennis Rivera, have visited Cuba. And compare this, for the last few days, we have seen the United States Congress, and that man sitting in the White House, trying to gut, destroy healthcare, Medicare and Medicaid in this country, to put over 24 million people to take health care away from them. Compare this to Cuba, where there is practically one doctor for every 750 Cubans, and health care is free. That is the value of the Cuban Revolution. So for the members of 1199, we have a commitment to end the blockade, and we will continue fighting because we believe that when we fight, we win, and we will win. The next person that I have the honor of introducing is a young man, an acclaimed Cuban jazz pianist. Please welcome Marcelo Casagrande. Marcelo.
Thank you for inviting me after so much talking and having so great people here. I think I will start playing first and then I will say something if you want. Thank you.
Thank you.
set up myself.
Bomba para la libertad,
bomba para la libertad,
Puerto Rico libertad,
bomba para la libertad,
la libertad,
la libertad,
la libertad,
la libertad.
Thank you.